Hello and welcome back to another episode of Unsung. You didn't get me, Russell. That's going to be our ongoing thing.
I almost got
you. Almost got me, but almost only counts in horseshoes.
I could have easily just dropped.
Almost only counts in horseshoes. Okay. We're back again with Kimberly Kelly in a second. We're going to start up. You can check us out on the web, unsung.us for past episodes, Unsung Everyday People on Facebook, Unsung US on Twitter, and unsung.us leads you to everything. If you have questions, comments, we're happy to address them all. We've been getting a lot of feedback from people, and it's all been good except for about the singing. It's all been good, and we're looking into different things. My name is Mark Hopkins. I am the chief of Greater Philadelphia Search and Rescue. I've been involved in emergency services for well over 20, 25 years in different aspects of it, and bringing attention to the different important jobs that people do where they don't get recognition. Not that they want recognition, but I think they should get recognition so that the next generation has an idea of different opportunities out there so they can help and make the world a little bit of a better place. And that's part of the incubus behind this entire show. We've got back Kimberly Kelly, who we had on before, and she was well received. She's a West Coast counterpart of mine. And between the two of us, you have a almost normal personality, with the differences between East and West. How are you doing, Kim?
I'm doing excellent. How are you?
Good, good. Can't complain. Love this time of year out here. We have a thing out here called seasons that you may not have out there as much. The trees
we
are...
We have seasons. We have beach season. We have fire season. We have...
Mudslide season. And
mudslide season. Earthquake season.
Well, we're doing one now we call autumn. It's nice to watch leaves change and everything changes over before it's autumn, which is I think that's Latin for transition from complaining about heat to cold. I think that's what it actually means. Wanted to talk to you. After our last interview, I had lots of people that like what you had to say, and we only really touched on what you had done locally, and I know that you have a lot more that you've done and want to talk about, and I'm pretty much freewheeling, and anything popped to the top of your head that you want to go over?
Oh, no.
No?
Somebody who has depression.
Well, thanks for coming, everybody, and we'll see you again next week.
But, you know, it's search and rescue is such a global effort, but it really varies no matter where you go, in ways really small to ways really big. And I know that over the last couple of decades, we've seen local search and rescue teams who have been deployed internationally that haven't always worked out so well. So is that a topic that you're interested in?
Well, sure. You're talking about the different types of teams. I guess we have local, we have regional, we have national, we have international.
Correct.
And they're similar but different animals. Tell us a little bit about your dealings with them. I know that you've been involved with one team that was regional or national and one that was international, maybe, or something. I'm mixing that up, but something like that.
No, you got it. So I first got into search and rescue with the San Diego County Sheriff's Department back in about 1993. And super great group of people in California, like many other Western states. Search and rescue is assigned to the county and the highest law enforcement agency in the county, the Sheriff's Department. And they have no way of funding all of the resources that they need for search and rescue. So they rely very heavily on trained background and volunteers who are affiliated with their agency. Now, if California needed more searchers in a county than the county had, and go to the state, and then the state deploys out other counties through mutual aid. It works very, very hand in glove with getting resources, getting volunteers, and getting the support that missing people need. In other states, it doesn't always work that way. You have independent states. Even though search and rescue in the county in California is assigned to the sheriff's department, there are lots of other resources. So FEMA teams, usually fire departments, and those are done by region. So you would have a task force up in Northern California in Menlo Park, and you have a task force in L.A. Same thing in Florida. You have Miami Metro-Dade, which does their usual fire business, but they are one of the most active teams. The Fairfax, Virginia team, very active team, and those come up for rotation. So if we have disaster domestically, like 9/11 or the hurricanes or floods in Joplin or Katrina, those task force are sent regionally. They don't do county things unless the disaster is in their county. Then you have your state teams or military teams. So, for example, you have the Coast Guard pararescuers and the jumpers with the helicopters, and they do all of the ocean water stuff. But then you also have your federal teams, and task forces like Fairfax or Virginia or Menlo fall under FEMA under that. So they would be attached to a fire department, but then they're under that federal system. Internationally, most countries cooperate very closely with each other when they need help. So the earthquakes in Afghanistan or in Turkey, in Armenia a number of years ago, the earthquake in Mexico City back during the late 70s, early 80s, those teams generally were, or those missions were generally before there were federal teams. And so oftentimes, there were great dog handlers from the East Coast, your neck of the woods, like Carolyn Hebert and Hatch Graham and Bill Dotson. They would be flown by the State Department to go to there, but that was all pre-9/11. Post-9/11, that would fall more under the federal teams and the FEMA teams, but it has to be requested by the country that needs the help. So, for example, when the earthquake in Haiti happened, everybody wanted to go, everybody wanted to help, and Haiti was welcoming of that. When the tsunami in Japan happened, Japan did not want those resources coming in. They had good resources of their own, but they also didn't want to expose other teams who were unfamiliar with the area or with this particular disaster. So that's kind of how that works. Where I've been involved, as you said, with a regional team here in San Diego, and then with a regional team at home in Colorado, but as an international team, one SRG based out of Moffett Airfield, we would be deployed when a single individual would go missing somewhere around the world. So, for example, a young man named Trevor Stokel, he and his girlfriend are backpacking, trekking in Nepal. He went out with his camera to go take some photographs, and he was never found again. So the State Department is not going to send an entire federal FEMA team for one missing person. And so that's where teams like ours come in and assist the family, provide searchers, provide resources, but also need to understand the local culture and regional needs that are expected and required.
Now, is there a cost for that? Is there a cost for that when you go? It's got to be some expense incurred to go to Nepal.
Yes. Yes and no. So the way our team, and I can only speak to how we do this, the way our team manage that is that we typically tended to go fast and light. So instead of a 12-person team with carrying enough gear for all 12 people, plus the porters, plus everything else, the operations I was involved in, we would have maximum 3 to 4 people and or a dog. And so the costs are considerably less. And the only thing that we ever charged for were actual hard costs. So everybody donated their time. Nobody was being paid. People took vacation time, or if they were self-employed, they took that time off from work. We always flew the basic class that we could get for airfare. So this was not a matter of we're going to go search for someone and we want first class. And reasonably, we were able to fund, for example, one search in Costa Rica for three adults plus a dog plus all of the international currency transfers, the insurance, the airfare, the boat rides, the hotel, the food, and bribes, because that's part of international SAR at times. We were able to fund that entirely for 21 search days for less than $7,500.
Oh, okay. For three people and a dog.
For three people, a dog, the boats, the airfare, the foods, the hotels, everything out the door and back again. 21 search days.
You know, I think people don't realize that with bringing resources into an area that the local authority, like you talked about Japan, is sometimes making decisions based on their better knowledge of their area. And when you bring in resources, SAR, USAR, or otherwise, it puts a strain on an already damaged infrastructure. And sometimes the weight of that strain isn't worth the gain of bringing the people up to speed, because unfortunately, many of these things aren't rescue operations. Many of them are recovery and demolition operations.
Correct. So, for example, in Haiti, many teams self-deployed, because Haiti's not that far. You know, you get to Florida, you pop on another plane, and you head down to the Dominican Republic or into Haiti. Haiti was not operational at that time. So there were large influx groups, people, individuals who just showed up. They weren't requested. They weren't required. They may or may not have had the skill sets, but they were there. Unfortunately, because it was so easy for them to get there, I don't think a lot of people, particularly on the individual level, really thought through that they're coming into a country that has been just devastated, is already poor, that you would be displacing already displaced people by taking hotels, and that there were reports of some groups that were literally going and asking other search teams for food and water because they hadn't brought enough.
Right. And that's just that's one of the many behind the scenes stories that people don't talk about. And self-deploying is I've always thought it was unprofessional. I just think that there's enough systems in place. I think if you self-deploy, people can say, oh, I want to help. And how do you help? But I think there's more. I think sometimes there's an arrogance there that, you know, I'm the one that can make a difference. I'm the stargate on this. I need to get there. And it just isn't that way. Nobody is all that.
Right. As we were talking about before the show, the gentleman that you were referring to who's put in 35 years, as he said, he did not come tomorrow, but this will still go on. There should never be any team or group of small people that is so dependent on one person. Everything has to have redundancies, including the people who are already there and the people who will be coming next.
You know, that's true, but that's easier said than done. I see more and more emergency services, and I see it. There was a low in it, but I see it's back to where we're dependent. The organization takes on the personality of a leader many times, and I see that with the next generation not stepping up as readily, I see that that person has just been there 5-10 years longer than they should have. Not for bad reasons, but they want to break too. And I don't see that there's the ability. We don't have the choice because of people's schedules being so tight, people being distracted, people not coming into emergency services at a young age anymore. There's so many reasons why we don't have those options that we used to pick the next generation of leadership easily.
Well, you're right. And there's lots of ways to look at it. I know, for example, I have a 16-year-old son, and he has grown up with search and rescue. He is a member of our team as one of our junior cadets. As a kid, he went with me to trainings and practices because children smell different than adults. We wanted the dogs to have that in their wheelhouse. He got his TAM license a number of years ago.